So, tonight we're gonna watch a movie, and the name of the movie is Anger Management. Has anyone seen it? Okay, quite a few of you. So this movie is really about, there's just a lot of theme in this, but you can see that this main character in the movie, he actually has, he's in this major people-pleasing pattern. He is not even aware of it. You know, just everything that he does in his life is about repressing his true feelings and to please others. And so for him, not even able to see that what he was doing, it's going to be very confusing to tell him to practice forgiveness, because when everything he's doing is about repressing and about people-pleasing, forgiveness probably will, you know, equate in his mind as more suppression and more people-pleasing and more self-attack. So today we talked about this self-hatred, and you can see that what is underneath people-pleasing and repression is really self-hatred. And he was sitting on this major chunk of self-hatred, and he wasn't even aware of it. So there was no way that he could really by himself get in touch or undo this pattern to get in touch with the self-hatred and then release it, then get into forgiveness. So this movie is really a beautiful demonstration of this major ego pattern of sitting with self-hatred and repress everything, and the attack is mainly inward attack, self-attack. Self-attack, and then holding grievance, really holding grievance silently around everything else, and yet in form, going around and people please with everything. So just day after year, that's the major life pattern. So really what happens for him, in order for him to really reverse or to get in touch with his true feelings, he really has to see this self-inward attack. He really has to see this self, deep self-hatred. You know, as we talked about this morning, you know, to the extent you can get access to the self-hatred, then you will start to go toward healing. And for him, and actually for a lot of us from in my own experience, it's not something that I'm aware and I can initiate on my own. So in his case, seemingly, you know, a teacher or all the external events and people are brought to his life just to be orchestrated so that all his inward and self-attack and self-hatred will first come to the surface. So there is no way that he could sit with it anymore. Then everything start to unfold from that point. So, you know, we always feel to tell everybody, you know, healing is not really our responsibility, but to have the honesty to look at what is underneath. That's all that really it takes. As long as we are not afraid and we're not hiding and protecting, we're willing to open a can of whatever that's underneath there, then the healing happens afterwards. And spirit will rush in to say, okay, you're open, and there's nothing that's protected or held against from the spirit anymore, then everything will be transformed. So, and this movie is really beautifully done, and you probably, while you're watching it, especially for those people who haven't seen it, you actually can watch your own, pay attention to your own emotional reaction to the movie as well, just to everything that he is doing and how the healing happens for him, just along the way, the steps. Just watch your own reaction, whether there is any charge or there is anything brought up, and we can have a beautiful discussion afterwards.
Because anything that seems to be happening where he's a victim, and it's almost like, oh, come on, that's not fair, that's not practical, that's where the conditioning that the ego is set up is seen. And actually, by the end of the movie, I won't tell you exactly how, but by the end of the movie, it's seen that it was all his own call. And all of his best friends are involved in the orchestration of this healing. So nothing was done to him, even by casual passengers or whatever. It's all, so that's what it's like in this world, like David was saying today. You people the world with your thoughts. That's really what it is. Nobody makes you upset outside of your own decision. You've actually brought them into your awareness to get in touch with the self-hatred. So this is a great movie for that.
Yeah, if you've got any grievance left, I mean, you can think that of how it would be to look at it as if it was all set up and these characters just acted it out. So you could feel this I feel pretty experience as they're dancing in the circle at the end. That was what it was all for. Because it's just how you look at it, you know. You could look at it as if it was done to you, apart from your wish, apart from your mind, apart from what you want. Or you could look at it as all done for you, for the healing, for the release, acted out so perfectly that you could release this hidden unconscious anger and guilt. I mean, what a masterful way when you just begin to open your mind to the idea that this, that everything has been working together for your good, and it was part of a perfect setup to feel free, to actually come to true freedom. Right mind has given you a new way of perceiving the whole world. And this new way is beyond the interpretations of the ego. It's above and beyond. So I said before time was linear, and that's where all the grievances come out. Attack, defense, victimization, all of the mistreatments come from this perception that the perceived world is doing something to the perceiver, and the perceiver is seen as a human being at the mercy of a hostile world that's outside. So the Holy Spirit instantaneously corrected that perception, and wherever there was perceived to be mistreatment or bad things or attack, that was just a wrong-minded perception. But when you open to this healed perspective, you see that what seemed to be bad was just a judgment in the mind on the self, projected out as if it was acted out what bad would look like. So, for example, let me give some examples. Oftentimes, one of the most heartbreaking perceptions in the world is a breakup. It could be a child dying, or it could be a parent dying, or it could be a husband or a wife saying, "I'm leaving you, goodbye." Or even, "I never want to speak to you again." And the perception is the perception of loss. That's the interpretation of the actions and the words. Like, there's a tremendous feeling of loss. Deep loss. Like, rip your heart out loss. And that feeling is coming from a belief and from thoughts. And when you clear away that belief and those thoughts, you suddenly don't feel the hurt anymore. You just feel bursting love and appreciation and gratitude. Now, even in this world, when you have, we'll say, a breakup, how many of us have gone through an experience of a breakup which seemed hurtful or devastating? And then doorways, opportunities, experiences that we hadn't even dreamt of, in the sense of imagined, open up, and we feel like we're growing, like we're evolving, like there's more love in our hearts than there was before. And we would have never believed that that would go that way, that after a heartbreak, there could be a more, a deeper experience, a more universal experience of love. That's like a little symbol of where this is heading. That we don't know our own best interest. That even when something happens where we say it's a tragedy, there's a beautiful blessing that comes and follows that was unanticipated. And that's like a little foreshadowing of what will happen when we let go of this tiny identity completely.
So it's a question about shift of perception in what has happened with you.
Yeah, shift of purpose. That's how you have a shift of perception, is you give the relationship a new purpose. And I hear witnesses to that all the time, where people invite the Holy Spirit and then things seem to shake up in their world, but they feel more expansive, more open after the shakeup. So the shakeup is like a rearranging of perception. And what is the rearranging of perception but rearranging it from this linear ego-based timeline to reordering it to come back to the moment and start to see closer and closer that it's all simultaneous, that it's all happening together. Like, for example, when you, has anybody in the room had like a strong deja vu feeling? Where you just suddenly, in one instant, you have this feeling almost wash over you, like, "I've been here before." somehow something is so familiar, like it's a feeling in our hearts, like, and yet the conscious mind, the ego will say, you've never been here, even though the feeling in our hearts says we have. And that's what the Course means by you're just reliving the same mistake over and over, the same patterns that repeat year after year and decade after decade. There's a familiarity, there's some commonalities to these patterns, thought patterns, and it's because we're still holding on to these same beliefs and grievances, and the characters change, the forms are a little different. But we find ourselves facing similar emotions and similar patterns over and over and over. And it's slowly our mind is shifting to start to realize that was our one problem. We were holding on to the past. We were clinging to the past and steadfastly refusing to let go of the past. And then the characters kept acting out those same past thoughts over and over. And that's the problem. When we let that go, we have a shift, a real full shift in perception, and we see the whole world completely differently.
I'm so glad you watched this. Because right down to saying earlier today, I can see that I really just sit here, sit pretty. I just feel very blessed by the mighty companionship I have right now, because it's flushing up something that I believe I never experienced, but is of course constantly there. And like, it's an experience of intense frustration, anger, and it really is self-hatred. And I can feel the thought is like, I don't want to be that character, I don't want to be in that role, I don't want to be that again, right? Since it's the past. But I'm happy to trade out for a different, better character. And I saw that it's almost like forgiveness to destroy, that he's used forgiveness, like, oh, you know, rising above it, I'm sure that guy didn't mean it yet, and you know, sister is in the mental side, and everything, and I'm like, oh, it's like listening to myself all my life, and all that right down to, you know, I'm not jealous, I'm not any of these things, and I have suddenly experienced everything in this today, and I don't experience jealousy. I haven't really ever experienced it today, flushing up. I'm just out of nowhere, and I'm just, all I've got is that I'm grateful, and I don't want to trade self-concepts, but I can still see, even with this willingness, that that's the belief that would do it, that there's a belief that would bring relief. And I don't want relief. I want to see this completely and to really experience that this is not who I am, my God. So anything you want to say, be great.
Yeah, this world is such an ingenious cover. I talked about cleverness and how it's an ingenious cover. It's designed to cover over and distract away from hurt and pain. There's so many avenues of distraction. So many avenues of forgiveness to destroy, of trying to convince yourself, well, at least I'm not as bad off as this, or I wish I had this, or I wish I was that, but it's not so bad. It's this not so bad defense mechanism that has no intention of letting go of the guilt. It's determined to keep things, you know, not so bad. Just listen to the words. Oh, it's not, you're not so bad. So-and-so's worse off. Comparison used. So I had a friend who moved from one continent to the next continent, and she told me that, she had a better career, better job opportunities. Many ways it was a great move, and what she found was that in the culture that she was raised in, you couldn't express anger, you couldn't express hurt, because those were signs of weakness. So the culture she was raised in was bravado. Keep it together, be strong. Don't ever let them know that you're hurting. Don't ever let them know that you're angry. That's a sign of weakness. You'll put yourself in a disadvantaged position. So hide it, bury it, and never let it be shown. And then she moved to a culture that was the flip side, where she had a boyfriend and met his family, and then went to a completely different culture where it was totally natural to let the emotions come up and through as fast as possible. Often like children do, you know, where children will just, they'll have their rage or their fit and face will turn red, and then 2 minutes later they're all starry-eyed and fresh and clean and clear again. It's just passed through. And so she told me she moved to this other culture, and it was just, I said, yeah, what a reflection of your belief to truly heal, where you could express all those emotions, not on just a daily basis, but momentarily when they would come up, and you wouldn't get frowns or glares or glances. You would actually be met with support, like people would feel, oh, you're going through a healing. Let's stop everything and let's let you move through this. So to me, those are just the symbols. Now, you know, it's like more and more you're feeling more safe and more secure, more surrounded by your mighty companions to actually let go of the mask, let go of any kind of bravado, control, you know, keep it together. You won't be loved if you don't keep it together. If you let it all hang out, or if you lose it, then you'll surely be rejected. You'll surely be cast aside, cast away. So to me, what you're describing is, yeah, this is actually the beginning of authentic healing. And some of you have heard me share that story of when Kirsten and I went down to South America, where we were down in Argentina, and to be traveling around with me, she didn't really intend on that. She just came over. She said earlier today she thought she'd just be helping as a secretary, assistant. She finds herself speaking in front of groups down in South America, and even using a symbol of rings. South America is 95% Catholic, and the symbol, it's much easier for a man and a woman to speak something and be heard, because it's such a receptivity to marriages, couples. That's a big part of Catholicism, as some of you know, from being here in Ireland. But she had so much resistance and darkness coming up that she didn't want to mention it or express it, but it came out psychosomatically in her body language. She was extremely stiff. And I would go to the groups and she would be there and she would be so rigid and so stiff that I would kind of make fun and light of it all with the groups. I would say, oh, I'm traveling with my partner, and it's like traveling with an ironing board. I said, we go to the hotels, flump, the ironing board goes on the bed. And then we go to a restaurant, flump, I sit the ironing board up. It was so stiff. It was so, talk about the stiff upper lip, it was so stiff and unexpressive that I said, it's great, it's like going to Argentina and all these wonderful places, romantic places, with an ironing board as your companion. And then we went to a French restaurant, and it reminded me of kind of like, almost like before a volcano erupts. It was kind of, the energy was, she's going to blow. She's going to blow. Because if stiff can only go so long. We have a lot of intense emotions. We can hold them back a while, but they're going to blow at some point. So we went into this French restaurant, and it's also telepathic that nobody was in the restaurant. It was just like a staff of maitre d' and like 7 or 8 waitresses, and a really fancy French restaurant in Buenos Aires. We go in there, we sit down, and the waitresses would come across and bring us like some bread and butter like they do in Argentina, you know, and they'd bring some drinks, some wine, and then they would almost scurry away from us because the energy of she's going to blow was so strong that the waitresses didn't want to stay too close because they thought this could get really explosive and messy. It was just like stiff and ready to blow. So this went on for some time, and finally she blew. And she just called me names and said things, you know, all the pent-up stuff that was kept in to be polite and kind and da-da-da was all there. It just came spewing out. It was like Linda Blair and The Exorcist or something. It just, no, nothing green or anything like that, but the head spinning. But it was just, it blew. It totally blew, and it just blew. And all the waitresses were as far away as they could be against the wall in the back, just kind of like trying not to look, but going, oh, like they couldn't. They were watching this scene. And then at the end of the scene, it probably went on for 5 or 10 minutes of just really expressing every attack thought, every hurtful thought, everything, whatever, all was there. Then at the end, she just said, well, okay, I guess this is over. That was the conclusion, you know, this is all over now and everything. And I remember at that point, I just slid my hands across the table, and I said, no, now we begin. Now we begin. See, the fear of letting it up or blowing up is the fear of ending, the fear of loss of love, the fear of rejection, the fear of goodbye. It's so intense that the mind will just keep it all bottled in there, and yet now we begin. And I don't know what, I think that was probably around 2005 or 2006, so here we are in 2014, 9 years later, and you see the presence pouring through Kirsten, and the grace, and the majesty, and the ease, and it starts with not holding anything down, not repressing, not denying, not playing this game of pretense. Well, when we talk about out, it's not like it's in the body. It has to be, you know, sometimes people do with the bataka sticks and, you know, they try to beat, or they put on their gear and they go and they hit and they just whack and everything. It's not like you can actually physically get it out, because it's not in the body. It's in the unconscious mind. So I would say that some of the processes we have online, like our clarity process, our instrument for peace, we have all these different tools. We watch movies. I told you the first time Kirsten saw this movie, yeah, she just was really upset, you know, at the treatment of the Adam Sandler character. I said, how did you like the movie? Did not like that movie at all. And then when she saw it again after a little bit of time, she saw it with whole new eyes. She saw the whole setup was all for the good. And it all came completely around to a whole new way of looking at it. She laughed through it the second time, but she, you know, was irritated, and it was bringing up anger. It was triggering all sorts of anger because of the interpretations of mistreatment. And, you know, we've talked about that. A lot of people have had that reaction to this movie when they first see it through the first time.
I saw with Clary that when Francis was saying about everybody in the movies helping Adam Sandler get to where he wants to go. And I saw that with real clarity. And I look back on my life and realised that it's been happening to me.
Yeah.
So the perception change comes from change of purpose.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And invite in spirit to help me with that.
Yeah.
Was spirit there anyway?
Yeah, like spirit's always there, but remember, you know, we actually have to go back to what seems to be the origins of this world, because we're used to thinking in terms of cause and effect. You know, what's the cause? What's the origin? And the Course in Miracles is so clear that God is not the origin of this world. You know, I mean, a lot of times I've seen course teachers that will actually work with the book, and there's even beautiful teachings like unity around the world and everything. that still have God having something to do with the world. Well, the Course comes out and says, you know, God did not create the body. Well, you know, that's one big thing. You know, God did not create a meaningless world. You know, that's another kind of thing. And then, you know, you get certain passages where your mind is still kind of like, oh, you know, that's, you know, I don't know for sure about this. And then he comes out in the workbook and he says, the world was made as an attack on God, a place where God can enter not. You mean you won't find that in Advaita Vedanta, you won't find that in ancient Chinese non-dualistic, you're not going to find it in any non-dual teaching to come out like that. It's like, for me, that's where Jesus is like, give it to us straight. We want to wake up, oh, okay, the world was made as an attack upon God, a place where God can enter not. There's another part in the Beyond All Idols sections where Jesus says, one sentence, four words, God knows not form. Ooh. So if I want to know God, and God knows not form, you can start to put it together, that we have to see that this world was made in hatred. That's what we could say. Most of us in the Judeo-Christian world, we read Genesis, right? I mean, that's what we were raised with. We were raised with Genesis. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So that's the story, right? So we say, and then on the seventh day, he rested. Okay. God rests, all right. And then Adam and Eve, and then, you know, the Garden of Eden. Okay, we're going along with the story and everything. And then, you know, and that part about creating Adam first and then creating Eve out of a rib of Adam. It's, if you're a woman, it's like, well, that's kind of, could have at least created out of a rib of the sky. But, so then you start, and then you got this tree where Adam and Eve are forbidden from eating. So right away, we've got a God who's got a paradise. And the one thing we're getting from this God initially in Genesis is forbid. I don't know if you want to have that to be your heavenly parent, forbidding. It sounds a little bit earthly to me, this forbid word. Earth parents forbid. Why would the God of eternity, of love, start forbidding? You know, already I have to start to question the story when God forbid Adam and Eve to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. First of all, Why forbidding? Why would the God of eternity be forbidding? Second of all, why put the tree in paradise in the first place to tempt Adam and Eve? That's a little bit sinister to me, a God of unconditional love. Forbidding and then putting a tree and saying, now, don't eat the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. What happens when you have children and you tell them not to do something? What happens when you tell children not to eat out of the cookie jar? What happens when you tell children keep out of the freezer, don't eat any ice cream? What happens if you tell a teenager, don't smoke? What happens if you tell a teenager, don't have sex? We know what happens. Forbidding and telling people don't do something when it's right in front of their face. Does this sound like something that the God of love would do? I'd say there's something fishy about Genesis. And this is the first book of the Bible. And I was raised with the whole thing, you know, so the first book. So, in A Course in Miracles, Jesus actually addresses Genesis. And he addresses the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And what does he say in the Course? God would never put you in such a position. Oh my gosh, this clever, ingenious puff of nothingness is even woven through Genesis of the Bible. And you can start to see that this world has an origin of hatred. It was made with the purpose of hatred. It was made as a projective device to try to get rid of hatred while still keeping it. as we talked about earlier, an ingenious device to keep you stuck in self-hatred for a millennium, which it invented as well. Time. So the world was made in hatred, but the Holy Spirit answered this with love, with forgiveness. And not, it didn't take the Holy Spirit time to answer. The Holy Spirit answered simultaneously. So now our job is simply to accept the forgiveness. Not that God has to forgive us, because God doesn't, oneness doesn't even know about a fall or fall from grace or separation. Oneness is still oneness. But if you're sleeping and dreaming and you forgot that love, then really you need forgiveness for yourself. Forgiveness of this tiny mad idea. Forgiveness for the belief you can be the author of yourself, that you can create yourself. That's what this whole course is really about. It's really forgiveness for you first, and therefore for the rest of the universe. Because it's really a forgiveness of identity. That you could accept a little tiny identity instead of the vast identity that God created you with. So this is the shift we're doing now. We're shifting from hatred to love. As I said in the parable of David, David was raised, he was very shy, he never talked to anybody, he didn't like to travel. He, you know, he was a wallflower, he was very isolated, very few friends, lonely, repressed, a lot of anger underneath, a lot of isolation, and then taking on a new purpose, this Spirit-given purpose has brought forth showers of witnesses of happiness, laughter, hugs, love, funny movies that are profound. You know, all these witnesses are flooding in because the purpose has shifted. And the world will simply reflect back to you the purpose that you hold in mind. So if you have a split mind, you really have a split purpose. You've got a death wish in there and a life wish. And as long as you hold on to both the death wish and the life wish, you're going to get mixed messages from the world. But once you let go of the death wish, then the world just reflects back to you your forgiveness, your life wish. So really, all this world is about is calling forth witnesses. And you all can probably think in your life of some of the most amazing, miraculous witnesses that you've drawn forth. You know, we've all had that. Now it's just letting the scales tip and saying, okay, I'm going to really go for it and crank it up, and I'm going to choose forgiveness as my purpose, and I'm going to draw forth all these wonderful, loving witnesses. While I still believe in time, I'll keep drawing forth more and more miraculous witnesses. And even just watching a movie like this, you can feel it happening, like your mind's already shifting. You're describing how you're already looking at those scenes, those memories, in a slightly different way. And it feels good. It feels much lighter.
The time aspect, well, as you speak about it, I can feel almost time is, what is it? You know, it doesn't feel linear. As you talk about it, it's almost become, I don't know how to describe it, just, it doesn't seem like it did an hour ago, you know?
Yeah.
And then the film there just almost twisted some cracks in my mind. Thanks, I think, very much.
Yeah. It really, it's very symbolic because, you know, we actually, the last couple of days, we also touched the topic of victim. And what is not obvious is that, you know, the split desire of the death wish, as well as the Christ identity, is also, you know, the death wish is also being a victim, identified as a victim. And the other one is identified as a Christ identity. So either we calling forth witness of we're a victim, you know, different scenarios to reinforce that I'm a victim of the situation, I'm a victim of other people. Or to see at the end of this movie, you probably all through the movie you think he's a victim of different scenarios, and he is just not fair. He's not fairly treated, and he didn't do anything wrong. You know, he kept saying that in this movie, I didn't do it anything wrong. I try to maintain alive so that I make sure I'm secure. You're nothing, the boat is not, you know, rocked because I'm trying to feel secure here. But what is the point of maintaining alive, a job, a relationship, where whilst he was sitting on the dynamite, you know, he couldn't really feel secure no matter what, without really tapping into what is underneath. He's going to be feeling like a victim, regardless. Probably the scenario, the specifics will change, but that is still a theme of all our lives. Even though in the dualistic world, you can seem to shift between a victim or victimizer. You know, sometimes I'm not a victim, I'm confident, I'm superior. But it's the same feeling, because you always can drop to the other side. You never feel truly secure and strong in one of the two, you know, aspects. So really, in the end, you know, when the healing happens, it's like a shift of the lenses and a shift of perspective. At the end of the movie, with all the things that happened, you wouldn't see him as a victim anymore, because that is his true healing and true help, is that everything was set up so that he really get in touch with what is really going on, and then he can really rise above. And that is the way that somebody, the perspective of our, you know, the way that we see ourselves and we see our lives will change as well, as we keep following the spirit, keep opening up to what is going on, not drawing conclusions. He didn't really spend a lot of time justifying why he was unfairly treated. I mean, but if we look at how we spend our energy, if we feel like a victim, we spend a lot of energy telling people about our stories and why we're mad and why we're, and how to fix those specific situation. And just imagine if that is all a setup. It's not really true, but it's all for a deeper purpose. But we can't see the purpose when we're focusing on the specifics. So just know there is a bigger perspective, there is a bigger reason for everything. And the purpose is to be able to get back to that bigger perspective. You know, and in the end, you know, we just keep giving our purpose to the Holy Spirit and allow Him to guide us. And then when all of these things that's been, you know, keep hidden, is brought to surface and being forgiven, we will see, wow, everything has happened for this. Everything has happened for me to open up and see that, you know, the one that is orchestrating everything for the healing is actually the same me. And I am all-powerful. I am the ruler of the universe. And that is, you know, finally the confidence and the strength will come in. It's who I am. That will shift. You know, not who I am will shift, the awareness of who I am will shift. So to say that not to be a victim in a specific situation, it's just like to say forgiveness in a specific situation. It is not really the genuine healing. You know, we're going for authentic healing from the bottom up.
Yeah, it says a lot in the course about not being able to fail. I suddenly feel I can't fail for the first time. There's a such a surety there of we can't fail. If this is the way it all works, yeah?
Yeah.
So thank you very much.
Yeah. Yeah, it's more than just escaping from the ego's world, because that's coming at it from the negative. It's accepting who you are, which really has nothing to do with the world or escape. You know, it just seems when you're trapped that escape is an important thing. If you're in a prison, you want out of the prison. There's something inside that says, I don't belong here. This is not me to be trapped. That doesn't feel natural to be trapped. But that's from the negative perspective. When you come into the fullness of identity, then it's like that workbook lesson, myself, capital S self, is ruler of the universe. Oh, that's a very different perspective than how can I get out? That's my capital self is ruler of the universe. And in that self, in that beautiful workbook lesson, we know the song from Lisa Moore, but it is impossible for anything to come to me unbidden by myself. Even in this world, it is I that rule my destiny. Even, this is from the Course, this is directly from Jesus. Even in this world, it is I that rule my destiny. What happens is what I desire. And what does not occur is what I do not want to happen. It just doesn't get any more clear than that. I mean, Jesus is like saying, you are doing it to yourself. And what happens is what I desire, and what does not occur is what I do not want to happen. That's just as direct as you can be. You know, there's no room for victimhood in that statement. It's totally ego-proof if you actually give yourself over to that one sentence. You could never be a victim. What happens is what I desire, and what does not occur is what I do not want to happen. So, it's that the unconscious is so buried that the mind will say, well, I didn't choose to be sick. I didn't choose to have a war in Syria. I didn't choose, you know, these things. Not consciously, but the mind is so powerful, if there's still unconscious desires and belief that you could separate from God and all the self-hatred from that, that's what seems to draw forth these witnesses that are not so loving. But the mind's getting exactly what it wants. It just doesn't know what it wants. It's split. It's got a split desire. It keeps vacillating back and forth between love and fear. And we can draw forth some beautiful, miraculous experiences, no doubt. But we also draw forth some very, very dark experiences while we believe in the hatred, the self-hatred. So it starts to come together. You know, you start to see, okay. And somebody mentioned too that everything that seems to happen to me, I ask for and receive as I have asked. That comes from a passage in the Course. I am responsible for what I see. I choose the feelings I experience, and I decide upon the goal I would achieve. And everything that seems to happen to me, I ask for and receive as I have asked. You could write those down. You could get tattoos of that one on one arm. And on the other one, what happens is what I desire, and what does not occur is what I do not want to happen. So, if you ever attempted to have a grievance in this world, pull up your sleeves and go, whoa, I am responsible for what I see, you know, that whole thing. And over here, what happens is what I desire. And there's just no room in there for a grievance, unless you really want to deceive yourself royally to maintain a stance that something's happened to me apart from what I'm asking for. And isn't that what the Bible said, really? As you sow, so shall you reap. Karma. What you give is what you get. Giving and receiving are the same. All that I give to myself. I mean, how many ways do we need it spoken to us, and how many traditions, and you can go with the different cultures and languages, the golden rule is there, the law of giving and receiving is the same. It's in all of the perennial wisdom. It's just that we need to practice it now, and we need to be gentle and kind with ourselves and release these attack thoughts, because they aren't serving us. How do you keep attack thoughts? Well, by seeing them projected onto the world and pointing the finger. Oh, there's the victim, there's the victimizer. You see, projection is a way of trying to get rid of something that you do not want, attack thoughts, by seeing them outside yourself. So, oh, this person did this. Oh, there's an evil world. Oh, it's a dog-eat-dog world. Oh, it's never going to improve. It's, you know, all these kind of dark kind of cliches and ideas are all just a projection of attack thoughts, as if the world's doing it to you. And then when you heal and you forgive, you start to realize, I have no need for attack thoughts at all. Am I ever upset because of what a person says? No. Even though that's all what we've been raised with. You make me mad. You hurt my feelings. You're making me angry. You better watch it. I feel hurt. You know, or it's it could be something that any character says. A mother says, oh, I gave birth to you. I suffered in childbirth for you. And you're not going to pick up that carton of milk for me on the way home. You know, I mean, it can come in many ways, many angles of all I did for you, and this is the way you treat your mother, your father, your son. You know, you see how it's common in the language. It's turning the screws. It's saying something outside of me has the power to hurt me. What does the Course say? I can be hurt by nothing but my thoughts. And what thoughts are those that hurt? Attack thoughts. And what's lesson number 23 say? I can escape the world I see by giving up attack thoughts. You see how he's got a real solid system of salvation. It's not kind of airy-fairy or, you know, like sometimes we tried our best with the Bible. We really did. I mean, there's so many sincere Christians who have read the Bible and have really just prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed to be shown. Please show me. Lead me. There are many, many sincere Christians. It's just now, 2,000 years later, with the Course. Wow. In case you missed it the first time around, it's so spelled out now. It's like, you know, you really can't miss it. You can't mess it up at this point. Not with all your angels, your mighty companions, clear teachings like the Course, step-by-step lessons, one lesson a day, really simple lessons. They aren't even complicated. It's only got two instructions that come with each lesson. You know, don't do more than one lesson a day, and as best you can, don't make any exceptions to the lesson. That's a pretty clear set of instructions. Two instructions and only one lesson a day to concentrate on. You can practice that at work, you could practice that traveling, you could practice that on the top of Mount Everest. You could get to the top of Mount Everest and be on whatever your workbook lesson is and just practice right there with what it looks like from the peak of Mount Everest. You see, you don't even have to be in special places. Convents, monasteries, around special people, you know, isn't that wonderful that you're given such a tool that you can just practice right where you seem to be without even having to change the form? It's amazing.
Can I ask a suffering, you know, see it in the world. What stands out for me is seeing homeless people, and that's something I kept thinking to myself as I was seeing them. What is that reflecting to me? Because I was seeing them in lack, I was seeing some of them in suffering, and also knowing it's a choice, I suppose. Could you just really, for me, I was probably saying when I was questioning this, I was probably saying to Spirit, like, Holy Spirit, you know, I want to release this. It hasn't released, I still see it, so is this something you could...
Well, yeah, I mean, to me, the most obvious symbol of having discomfort around perceiving homeless people is that the mind that is perceiving the world, even perceiving a world, is homeless in the ultimate sense. We have movies like The Wizard of Oz with Dorothy, you know, seemingly being taken up in a cyclone and going through this very difficult time with the Wicked Witch of the West and flying monkeys and and sadness and all kinds of things. It's like a little metaphor of The Wizard of Oz. One of the more recent movies was Steven Spielberg, E.T. And when you reach the point where it's E.T. phone home, everyone, oh, everyone cries because there's a homeless little creature there, a little green homeless creature with a skinny neck and big, beautiful eyes, and everybody who's watching the movie has fallen in love with E.T. and phone home, and the little boy who's going to help him, you know, with all the police and everybody trying to get him, you know, he's going to take him on his bike and put him in his basket and pedal as hard as he can to help E.T. go home, to phone home and go home. And then ultimately the bikes of the boy and all the other boys are all lifted into the air. And everyone, you know, because you want E.T. to go home. You follow the looks of the story, you know, it's our story. That's our story. Steven Spielberg is putting it in a little cute little creature. I just recently, my three-legged cat passed, but she had a face that was so adorable. I always said, if she ever gets discovered by Hollywood, you know, I'll lose her because she'll be starring in some famous movie like E.T. But she stayed with me and meditated all the way. It was not distracted or tempted with Hollywood. But that's, you know, underneath it all is this deep desire to go home. Now, how do you undo that? Well, miracles, there's no order of difficulty in miracles. So back in the 1990s, when I had a group of students that I was working with real closely every day, we would do all kinds of things. One time in Denver, I sent them out two by two into the streets of Denver with like $20 each to give it over to the Holy Spirit, and they came back with all these miraculous stories of encountering people on the streets and how the Spirit poured through them and sometimes through the homeless people, the miracles, the wisdom that they heard. It was just, we all lit up together. Other times I would go like in downtown Cincinnati and they would like follow me around just to see how I interacted with everyone, because it's so spontaneous. It was so in the moment. It's just, we're here to extend love, but we have to be inspired by the Spirit to do that. We can't just pretend to know what to do based on our past learning. And we've had that experience. I've had that experience in third world countries and many, many, many experiences where the miracle sees no difference between somebody in this world who seems to be very wealthy and well-to-do, but is crying out in their soul because they feel very lonely and isolated, and somebody who seems to be on the street, who seems to be lacking in the material things. The Spirit just shows us the sameness of everything, that it's always our own call for love, our mind's call for love. And the only way that we release ourselves is by being in the service of Jesus and the Holy Spirit and teaching ourselves what we would learn over and over, extending the miracle, extending the miracle, extending the miracle. It grows stronger and stronger in our awareness, and someday it starts to dawn on us like, oh my gosh, I am a miracle worker. When we were little, we would never have even given ourselves the consideration of being a miracle worker. That's reserved for the saints and Jesus and everything like this, Mother Mary and all these ones, but it's literally for us. And so when you step into it, then that's when you feel your heart bursting open. There was one time where there was a friend of mine, Mary, and Kirsten and I had just finished a Course in Miracles gathering in St. Louis, Missouri, and we came out and we were just so bubbly and lit up and happy, and we were walking down the street and this man we saw from across the street came limping, dragging himself across to us, and he was limping and he was curled up and he was shaking and he was saying, can you help me? Can you help me? And we were also lit up that if they had recorded this, like a video recording, we were so absolute in the glory of God and the truth that he would say things like, I'm in great need, and I need this, and I need that, and he was stuttering and everything. By the time the interaction finished, like in 5 minutes, his stutter was gone, the man straightened up, his limp was gone, and he still felt that he needed to buy something at the store across the way, which I handed him the money that he said he needed for, and he had a smile on his face, and he walked straight across the store with no limp, no curl, no stutter. We just were all just laughing because we absolutely were so much in the truth that we couldn't see anything else but that. We were just glowing and radiating that, and then his image just lit right up to reflect our mind. But it was a real quick transformation, almost like a new character was reborn. Yeah, but it's the power of the mind, you see that. And I see it all the time, like when I was in Argentina, I oftentimes would go to groups and people would come in and, you know, curious and this, but serious on their faces. And then as the evening would go on, the faces light up, the eyes start to sparkle, bright flashing smiles, bursting laughter, you know, and then my translator sitting next to me, looking out on the crowd as they're translating while I'm speaking, and they're going, this is like a box seat. I got the best seat in the house. I'm watching the whole place light up with the miracles. And you can see the shift when people, because everybody knows this inside. We're not talking about anything new. Everybody recognizes this, you know, and when they're receptive, they just, their faces light up.
Yeah, even like in this, watching this movie, you know, if there is a perception of victimhood or unfairness, it's the mind interpreting it and still believe. There is a belief in the mind. That's why that's what you see and what you interpret in a specific situation. But, you know, of course, for people who have seen it a couple of times, they know the whole picture. They stop interpreting it that way. And if that applies to everything, to Oprah's our lives, we trust the Holy Spirit so much. We have seen the miracles so many times. Then when situations come up, a new situation come up, even if there is kind of temptation to slip into the wrong-mindedness and the old interpretation, you somehow feel, even like watching this movie halfway, if I tell you, you know, the first half is all a setup, then you watch the second half, you will think, well, maybe, let's see, let's stop. Just stop interpreting for a moment and wait and see. Maybe this is a setup too, you know, you stop straight away judging the situation and interpreting. And that's what I find, you know, when we follow the Spirit and the trust just start to grow. The more we follow, the trust start to build up and we see everything that work out together for good. So we actually wash away all these interpretations, victimhood thoughts, you know. And even what is life, when you change the definition, interpretation of what is life, you stop interpreting death the same way. So perceiving death and sickness, there will be not association with suffering to that anymore. So when people sometimes ask me questions about vegetarianism and killing animals, there is a genuine unable to interpret killing animal as death, animals being dead, because there is no life in flesh. Therefore, there is no death in flesh in and of itself. So therefore, you can see how that applies to everything. You know, the whole interpretation about this world, it just all changed, transformed.
Trying to find happiness attachment to the happy seeing world. I already mentioned it, I know, I just feel that I see now maybe a different level of it. Because everything is connected. This movie just brought up this. So, it seems like it's more difficult to let this go. And why is it so difficult? Because I have a feeling that maybe that's why. Because I don't know who I am really, and all I know is these experiences, and I have a feeling that I want to let this go, but I will let this go only if I already saw what I am really. I mean, and then I can be ready to let it go. So it's like a trade of course.
Yes. Yeah, that's exactly it, in the sense that what I always say is the Holy Spirit has the convincing job. You shouldn't ever try to take on this spiritual journey as a human being. Put it all on the Holy Spirit. Say, it's all on you. You convince me. And who would give up something that they still believed was valuable for the big question mark? Something that's promised. You know, it's almost like somebody coming to you and say, you know, I'll marry me and I'll give you free diamond rings and I'll buy you a big house and all these promises. And you have to feel in your heart, is this one for real? is this happening to me? Is this really happening to me? Is this for real? Because you have to discern whether it's an actual honorable proposal or it's not. It's the same with the Holy Spirit. The Bible has many promises in it, and the Course has many promises in it, and yet you need to be convinced, you need to have experiences that actually show you, that demonstrate to you that it's true. So this is where there's no sacrifice, and I know during the one-on-one that Don and I had today, I was giving all these beautiful parables of how the Holy Spirit can use your ego belief system, uses your preferences even, uses the things that you still desire, and turns the tables right on the ego, because it uses those very things that you still prefer to show you beyond a shadow of a doubt that you're perfect. And so I call them whims. Now, what's the difference between a whim and seeking outside yourself for satisfaction in the world? Well, when you're seeking outside of yourself and you want something, let's say you want a partner or a spouse or a nice house or a nice house and three cars or to live in this country or to live in that country or to live by the equator where it's warm all the time and tropical, whatever you have in your mind that you think would give you a better life, if you turn those into goals, then again, you've made those goals into an end, and you will use your mind as a way to get those goals. And then the mind is the means, and the body, of course the body is the great benefactor of all the minds toiling, going to meaningless jobs and doing meaningless things just to earn money, so guess who can be the benefactor? The body is always the benefactor, and the mind has to slave away doing things that it really wasn't made to do in the first place. It wasn't created. You think God would create a mind to do math? You think God would create a mind to read or speak or navigate time and space when God doesn't even know of time and space? You know, the ego has made up this whole mechanism of the mind, the brain, the body, and everything. And now the mind is a slave, and guess who the king and the queen is? The body. So now you're feeling joy bubbling up in you, strong joy. That's leading you on. It's leading you towards deeper experience of the miracle. It's leading you down the rabbit hole towards the atonement. But you still need to be convinced. So that's a beautiful prayer to pray to the Holy Spirit, is convince me. Convince me I'm the Christ. Bring it on. say that to the Holy Spirit, bring it on, and be ready for the ride of a lifetime. I've noticed whenever you put that in your prayer to the Holy Spirit, bring it on, the Holy Spirit's like, well, thank you for the invitation. He's got his hands going up. That's the way it is. Because the Spirit's ready, more ready than ready. You know, the Spirit's more ready than you could ever be. And it's just waiting for the invitation. Because the Holy Spirit can't come like on a search and destroy mission with the ego. It can't come unbidden. It can't. You can't, you know, say, no, not really, not now, not now, and have the Holy Spirit, you know, come in. So you're in the midst of, you can feel it happening. It's the beginning of the great journey into joy. And all you're asking is to be convinced every day. You're not, there's nothing on you, nothing on Sandy, where it's like on your shoulders. Like, oh, what have I got to give up now? And do I have to give up my parties? And you know, that's how the ego thinks. It's like, hey, when I'm in South America, that's the favorite word, fiesta, fiesta. You know, it's everything's fiesta, fiesta. I'm like, yeah, let's go for it.
I should let, because I see, you know, metaphysically that I'm searching outside of myself, so that's why I'm thinking that, okay, because I'm searching outside of myself, I should be able to let these things go. For example, boyfriend, parties, and I feel guilty about it, that I feel that I can't. Or I'm not ready, or all this stuff. So I just have to pray then that please promise me.
Yeah, Spirit actually can use everything. So when things are still in your life and still serves the mind to open up and forgive, the Spirit can use all of these things. There's nothing in and of itself is bad or good, you know. And then if it reach a point that you start to outgrow things like party, you start to really see that, you know, there's other things that you would feel more inspired to get into, that's the time that Spirit really is at work. He will draw you to the next things. It's always going to be through inspiration. And it's really just before that step, when we think ahead of time, project onto the future, that's the most fearful, thinking that we have to do it, we have to give up what, you know, we will still have, and project this big unknown, and it's so scary. But when it really reach the point when you outgrow that, and that's the only reason why you need to give up, is it doesn't serve your awakening anymore. And when you reach that point, it's not really scary. Everybody thinks it's a really hard, scary journey, because almost like we have to give up something that is valuable. No, we only need to see what is truly valuable and valueless. And when we see that, the valueless will drop at its own time, you know.
And what would be better than a party, or going to parties, than if your whole life was one continuous party? You can imagine. I mean, that's the only thing that could be better, you see, in your awareness. It's like, wow, if you were in such a jovial, happy, joyful party frame of mind, you know, a party's a celebration. You know, that's really when you can't even look at human beings and say, wow, they work, they try so hard, they're spending so much of their day to survive. And then when they have a party, you know, it's like, oh, give them a break, you know. When people have a vacation, they work 50 weeks of the year or 51 weeks of the year, and then they have a week for vacation or 2 weeks. Even that's just a symbol of take it easy, take a rest. And eventually, when you do the mind training, it turns around to a full-time party and a full-time rest. Imagine a restful party, you know.
Yeah. 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 Because
sacrifice.
Always giving up things and sacrifice. And I don't understand why that can be, that I see these things metaphysically, because I feel that intellectually I understand it, but then still, it still pops up.
Yeah, I think the thing is, just with what you've done in Budapest, is, you know, you try many, many things. That's what the world is. Jesus says that those who come to this world will seek, because that's what they've come for. Everyone who seems to come to this world is a seeker by definition. There's not anybody that slips past. We even have stories of the virgin birth. No, Jesus seemed to come as a seeker too. And he was tempted in the desert, and he had to go through the same temptations that all of us have to go through. That's what makes him a good way shower. I don't know about you, but I don't know if I would necessarily follow one who was born the King of Kings and he was the Christ at birth. It's like, oh, great. Nice advantage. Good start there at the womb. I start out as an ego and you start out as the Christ. Okay, you're the way shower. How come you got such a head start? No, he had to come to this world and go through the same temptations that all of us did and transcend them, which makes him a beautiful role model and an example that you can really join with as a friend and a companion, as an elder brother. He's been through it all and he's come soaring right through it. And I think that's the thing for you. You can start to realize, well, I'm going to keep being drawn into these experiences, and already you can see how even your work with the Course, it's becoming more of your life. You know, you're being drawn in by the joy, drawn in by the miracles. There's nobody twisting your arm, you know, saying, Sandy, you better become a miracle worker. Or it's not even your mother, you know, saying, you know, come on, you know, my daughter's supposed to be a miracle worker, the next, you know, Jesus Christ, and, you know, don't slack off there. You've been doing your miracles this week. You're not. There's nothing pushing you. You're being drawn voluntarily through your heart. And that's just going to grow and grow. Because none of us, Francis, I, the messengers and everything, you know, we were all clueless about really spirituality. We all have our own different stories. You know, Francis says that she was raised in an atheistic family and basically it was about education and upward mobility and success and independence and being strong and independent. You know, there was nothing about, like, she doesn't say, oh yes, I was raised in the ancient non-dualistic traditions of Taoism and Buddhism and this and this, and I came to America in a lace dress and angels were surrounding me. I came to the West to bring the non-dualistic truth of the Orient, you know. But she said, no, she came to the University of Chicago to get the best job that she could get and make the most money that she could. You know, it was, none of us had pure motives. We come just as clueless as everybody, and then somehow something happens, like with me getting into the Course. Francis was into the Course. She had a large Course group in Sydney. You know, even before I met her, she was doing it. But you're drawn in, and then you, deeper you get into it, you go, what is this? Where is this taking me? What? This isn't even human. And it's like, it isn't. There's really nothing human about it. It's just using the symbols to convince us of our divinity. I mean, so convince us that we have such certainty of who we are that we never doubt again. We never look back. We never go off. We just come into certainty.
Yeah, I mean, my dream, my childhood dream is to be able to travel, and I have to, you know, in my own mind, I have to make it happen myself. I have to earn a lot of money, and then one day when I retire at time and I have a lot of money, then I can travel around the world. So when I, you know, started to follow this journey, I thought I have to give everything up. I don't know, I will never have money again. I don't know what is, you know, in front of me. But really, and my mom was saying, you would never be like David to live in divine providence. It works for him, but not working for other people. it's not going to be working for me. But when I really just, you know, seek first the kingdom of heaven, everything will be added to you. Now I travel, I'm not doing it on my own. I'm not, you know, trying to make it happen on my own, earn the means so that I can achieve this. You know, it's just become a constant holiday and just to do what I'm passionate about and everything is provided for. And now I hear people saying to me, you can do it, but I can never do what you do, living in divine providence. It doesn't work for others. I was like, but I heard this before.
It's back.
Yeah. Do you think the ego is like a split off part of my mind, is that correct?
Yeah.
And my higher mind is still intact. Figure out if that's the right word even to use, as to why part of my mind was split off from the perfection it was.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the, I call it the number one question really around the world. That's, you've come to the number one question, and it has different forms. You know, how could it split off? How did the impossible happen? To whom did the impossible happen? It just comes in many, many variations. And in the clarification of terms of the Course in Miracles, Jesus says, the ego will ask many questions that this Course has no answer for. But he does say that there will be an experience that will come that will end your doubting. So the ego is the questioning mechanism of the mind. It asks the first question, what am I? And then every question, got milk, and everything other question that comes after it is all of a reverberation of the first identity question. Christ never asked that question. So when we get into this part of trying to understand the split off, like how could such a thing happen and so on and so forth, there is a point where you start to realize, okay, well, wait a minute, maybe I should go back in the text then and look at what it's actually saying. And it's saying, you know how we talked about responsibility today? That's been like a major theme. It says the sole responsibility of the teacher of God, at one point he says, and the sole responsibility of the miracle worker is to accept the atonement for himself. So maybe the answer to the question, if we go in deeper, is in the atonement, because that's our only responsibility. All these earth responsibilities are made to reinforce guilt. How good is a good enough father? Does anybody, a good enough father, a good enough mother? You see how it's all a setup, so that we'll always feel like we're lacking, we're not living up to the standard. There's always better, you know, we're less. How good is a good enough lover? How good is a good enough citizen? You know, whatever. How good is a good enough Course in Miracles student? You see, it can take many forms and very subtle forms. But the atonement is the goal. The atonement is the sole responsibility. And how does Jesus define the atonement? He says that it's the experience that the separation never occurred. You see, that is the experience at which the Course aims. It doesn't promise us theological answers to impossible questions, because the whole book was written as if, he puts the two words as if in italics to really emphasize it, as if the mind is split, as if the separation occurs. The Holy Spirit has got to put it in a form that humans can relate to. It would be like if Jesus showed up 2,000 years ago and said, all is one. Good afternoon, good evening, and good night. Poof. And he was gone. He just appeared as an apparition. He was here for 10 seconds. He said, all is one, good afternoon, good evening, good night, and then poof, he was gone. You wouldn't even be reading about this guy in the history books. Probably somebody would go, whoever saw it would go, I think I'm hallucinating. But no, he was here for 3 years. Publicly, traveling, healing, teaching, sharing, giving examples, correcting from the bottom up, and demonstrating love in action. It wasn't a 10-second little, all is one, and good afternoon, good evening, good night. So really, there's no conceptual answer to the question. It's part of a loop that the ego is looping in. But when we actually give ourselves over to the Course and we say, there's got to be a better way, like Helen Schuckman said, you know, to Bill Thetford, and we actually give ourselves to apply it, then we are drawn into an experience that the separation never happened. But inside the loop, you know, all the evidence points to that it did, because it's made out of belief, and there's no beliefs in heaven. It's just like a circular belief that keeps witnessing, you know, to the original belief in separation. We have to demonstrate it. In other words, in the end, it won't be through our eloquent speaking that we demonstrate it. It will be through our attitude, our happiness. God's will for you is perfect happiness. That's going to be our demonstration of the truth. And we may not say a word at that point. You know, it's just going to be, whether you speak or not, it's all involuntary, but really it's your attitude that's the teacher. Well, let's go to the first part. That if you said, if I was created by God, I would say, now that's a fact.
Okay?
Now, if that's a fact, that everything has to have a source. Everything has to have a source. And who you are has a source. Now, the question then comes to, sometimes people ask me, well, what's the source of the ego? You know, that's another version of coming at it from a different angle. But actually, the ego has no source. Sometimes I call it a bastard child. It actually has no identity and it has no source. It's causeless. And coming to that experience of the causelessness of the ego and the cause and effect relationship between God and Christ, that's everything. So we start to realize that as long as I'm caught up in linear time and the story, then I believe that the ego is my father. I believe that I said that the ego created the body or made the body. As long as we identify with the body and the story, we're saying, in essence, that the ego is our creator, our father. And then once we let go of our identification with the body, we let our mind be used for miracles and washed of the identification with the body, then we come back into alignment with God as my source. So one of the YouTube, somebody may not know, Andy might know, what's the title of the one, Who's Your Daddy? That's one of my YouTubes. Who's Your Daddy? This question could be asked 1,000 times a day. Who's my daddy? Who do I give my allegiance to? To love or fear? To eternity or to time. So when you look at it in terms of like the intellectual mind is going to want to draw a reason. You know, you're asking the question which in the world seems like the most reasonable question, why or how. Those are like two of the most basic questions. But I still come back to that Immanuel Kant thing of how do we know what we know? If there's love in us and love created us, we must have that still within us. That must be the answer. whatever the question is, love must be the answer. But it has to be an experience. It can't be another concept to answer the concepts.
It's a question that has been plaguing me for that long time. And it's like, even talking about it now, it's like, I don't know, it's fear or anger that's coming up to me, but it's, I'm not quite sure, but I can feel it in my stomach. Yeah. And I don't know if I'm angry with the answer I'm getting, or whether it's fear or I'm asking the question. Something there, I'm not sure what it is. It's like I've suppressed something for an awful long time. I'm not sure exactly what I've suppressed. I know what you're saying, if I'm operating from the ego mind, I'm in a loop and I'm going around the circles looking for answers in the wrong place. I try so many times to connect to spirit and to my higher mind, my real self. And it's got me here, in one sense. And it's like, what's the next step? And yet I went over to Spain for a month in Abazina. And I found a lot then quite difficult. I wasn't happy, not much more than I was before I went over in my own world. I found it, it's difficult enough. And then I had another month in Abazina, 2 weeks in Abazina and 2 weeks in France. And I can't say that it was joyful and happy. Maybe I was going through a transition. I have to allow for that as well. And I'm at a difficult stage in myself. It's really what is my next step. And it's like the book answers so many questions that I've been asking myself for so long. And yet this other crazy question keeps coming up, it's like there's no answer for it. And I know listening to you talking today and yesterday, there's such clarity coming from you, and I can really identify with it. And yet there's this thing going on within me, and I'm not sure exactly what it is. It's like a fear and an anger together or something. To express it properly, or it's like I'm stuck in that strange place. I can't say further than that right now. And maybe you can talk a little bit about where I am.
Yeah, this thing that you can't really put a finger on is like a thing kind of called readiness. As you know, some people have said, I'm willing. I wouldn't be here if I wasn't willing. I have willingness. And the Course keeps saying, you have to keep coming up with, that's your part, a little willingness. The Holy Spirit's job is the convincing. It's your part, it's just a little willingness. But I say sometimes to people, even if you're willing, if you're not ready, out of fear, even the willingness, you have to be patient with the willingness, because you know how they have that cliche, ready and willing. You know, it's a kind of a powerful combination, ready and willing. The readiness we can't put a finger on, because you could even say metaphorically, it's like from lifetimes, like the Arantia book some of you have heard of, where Jesus had like 7 bestowals on earth. It wasn't until his 7th bestowal he was ready to boom, pop through the veil for all of us. The first one to, this is a very clever, ingenious cloaking device. We put forget the fig leaf of Eve having to cover an Adam with a fig leaf. We've got a cosmic fig leaf we're dealing with of time and space that's covering over our divinity. And Jesus had so-called seven bestowals before he finally really got the ultimate lesson, that none of it was real. And so I see what you're talking about is, I see your willingness because, you know, you came to Alazena, you've given yourself over to these teachings, and yesterday or the day before, I had a call with a friend of mine in Australia, and she's been on this journey for years working, and one day she just burst into tears, and she just cried a river for like 3 hours, like sobbing. And all the while she was sobbing, she was trying to use her affirmations and course lessons. It was like an uncontrollable hurt sobbing, like an uncontrollable grief for 3 hours. Tears, tears, tears. And she was raised Catholic, so all she kept thinking of was like Fatima, like Mary, and the tears coming down Mary for the whole world, you know. And when I talked with her, she said, you know, I am getting this feeling after these 3 hours of crying that there's something really important that I'm here for. And that I have a very important task or calling that's what all of that tears was about. Like, it's unnecessary. Suffering is unnecessary. Tears are unnecessary. There's something to get that shows that all of that is unnecessary. It's so important. It's for the whole universe. It's not for you personally. It's like it's for the whole universe. That's why you're here. You're here as the savior of the world. Not personally, but in mind. And so I would read this part in the Course where I had all these questions, and the Course would help with the answers. And then I read the part where Jesus said, "Are you ready to help me save the world?" It turned around, it was a question for me. You know, are you ready, he said, to help me save the world? It's like he's saying, I need you. I really need you. This was like the Spirit of Christ calling and saying, I need you. And for me, that's what I talked to my friend about. After those 3 hours of crying, she was saying, can you help me? What is happening to me? What is going on with me, with these tears for 3 hours? I said, you are being activated. There's something inside you that is becoming activated to your calling. And all of us, we just come to it when we're ready. It's not something we can do, like exercise or even practice to speed it up. It's like when we're ready, we are activated. And when we are activated, there's no stopping us. It's like a time lapse, like a time bomb goes off in us, where something inside of us goes, enough, enough, enough of the error, absolutely enough. There's something that rises up inside, and it's like it's so strong, and the Christ just connects with it immediately. It's like, yeah, here we go, when you get activated. So that's really what you're just opening to, is that activation. And it's such a closed loop that even if you go and have some experiences and it's difficult, this is not surprising. If you talk to different volunteers in our community, they'll tell you about the difficult times. Andy is with us here. He's flown all the way from Mexico, and he's come through 12 steps, and he's come through like depression medication and cycles of depression and hung in there, and he kept coming back because there's an activation that's happening inside there. It's like, here I am, Lord, do you know it? I'm coming. And even with all these dark things that come, you know, there has to be that activation that carries you through, that where you gain a sense of confidence that you won't be stopped. You know, you won't be stopped.
Yeah, I mean, I know what you're saying about being sick of myself and this kind of a crazy world I live in. And yeah, that's what's bringing me here. And yeah, I remember reading Awareness years ago to Tony DeMello, and he's saying, when you're sick of your sickness, you'll do something about it. And to me, that was a great phrase.
Yeah.
And I have felt that various different times over the years. I'm sick of this place. I'm not home. I'm not happy here.
I think it's the thing too of, like Sandy was talking about, as you work with this course or you work with spirituality, you watch things arise. It could be something in your mind like, I like my parties, not ready to let go of my parties. I would like a boyfriend. Send me a boyfriend, that would be very nice for my mind training right now, or whatever it is that starts to come up. We do have to allow everything up, you know, because we're allowing the darkness up. We have to let all our desires up, we have to let everything up. And I think that's very authentically a beautiful, beautiful step of coming to self-honesty. You know, like I had a friend of mine who was like a first violinist in a symphony, and he invited me to his town to speak at his Unity Church, and I was in the middle of the afternoon talk, and he's the guy hosting me, and he goes, well, I started talking about lesson 128, the world I see holds nothing that I want, and the host put his hand up, and he goes, that's when I shut the book. He said, I made it to 128, and I opened it up, and I read, the world I see holds nothing that I want. And I just said, that is not true. And he closed the book. He looked at me and he goes, so? And I said, well, 129 is an amazing lesson. And he said, what's that? As he actually shut his practice at 128. And it was, beyond this world is a world I want. You see how Jesus never rips anything out from you, never rips the rug out without giving you what you truly want. He just doesn't work that way. He's not like, keep moving the goal, keep moving the cheese, you know, away. Just when you keep grabbing for it, he moves it higher and higher. That's what the ego's doing. The ego's giving us false cheese, and we never can get the cheese, you know. We just keep grabbing for it, seeking and seeking and not finding. Jesus says, seek and ye shall find. Knock, and the door shall be open. Remember that from the Bible. He's positive he can deliver on his promise. And he's positive too that the ego will never deliver on its death wish. You know, it wants you dead. And Jesus knows that's not going to happen. So once you start opening up in that authentic way, you will have these little decision points where it's more like we've talked about, you outgrow things. It's not that Francis let go of this and let go of that. I think really you just outgrew them. And just like a child outgrows toys. You know, there's no big announcement when the toys are left in the yard or in the hallway. They don't go, okay, this is it. It's the last time I will ever ride my tricycle. Now I want everybody to come here and let's have a little prayer here for the last time. It's no big event. It's gone. I mean, they just don't use the toy anymore. They've outgrown it. That will continue. Just take heart in that. That will continue. That's how the spirit works.
Yeah, it's just in a strange place. I see, you know, I see the messengers here, and I see you, and I see a lot of people here, and I can see that.
Well, if it helps too, I say this a lot in my travels around the world, but I feel like every person that I meet, we are lifelong companions on a very, very high goal. And that is the way that I feel. It feels so profound that our meeting is not by accident, that we've come together for the highest purpose there could ever be. And that purpose takes top priority over everything. It's like, reminds me of that song, a friend's a friend forever, if the Lord is the Lord of them. You know, that's the feeling that I get. And this is nothing casual. This is a very, very deep commitment. You know, when we talk about commitments between husbands and wives and family commitments, this is a commitment to a wake-up call. And that's what's called us together in this room. It's in a quantum way. We're calling forth witnesses to what we truly want in our heart. We are activated, you know. We are not here to mess around. You know, we're not here to dilly-dally. We're not here. Delay is not our purpose. It's actually miracles, saving time. And everyone contributes fully to that. We're all, it's like this room is a collection of thoughts of desiring to wake up with God. We've surrounded ourselves with a collection of those witnesses. That's quite an amazing thing when you look at a lifespan and you start to see these kind of collections showing up. And these kind of movies that we're having this year. I mean, we used to like wait every 3, 4, 5, 6 months, and we would get a real gem where we'd all be jumping up and down like, oh my gosh. And we would all go and watch it and savor every frame, you know, like, can you believe it on the big screen? It's like, Groundhog Day. You know, funny, but it's a loop. And Bill Murray was in another movie called The Man Who Knew Too Little, where he was told at the beginning of the movie that it was all theater. And so they try to poison him, kill him, shoot him, strangle him. They do everything that you would say is the worst thing that could happen to you in the world. And he laughs his way through all of that, not feeling like he's even having a bad day, because he's got the mindset that it's all theater, improv theater, and it's coming at you, that it's just play, it's play acting. Even when the bullets come and dust from the bullets spark into his eye, he'll go, hey, hey, watch it. Almost like, hey, that's a little real. And he's back in his happy frame of mind. They can't strangle him, they can't shoot him. Even at one point, they give him truth serum because they think he's an invincible American agent, you know, because he's so fearless. He's simply got the mindset that it's all play acting. So he doesn't take anybody who's going to try to hurt him, rob him, beat him. And they tie him up, they gag him, they do all these things. Finally, they give him this truth serum. And they're trying to find out, they think he's an American super spy. Which country do you work for? They give him this truth serum. Which country do you work for? Who do you work for? Who do you work for? He goes, he's got his blindfold on. Blockbuster Video, Des Moines, Iowa. The truth serum works. And they go, oh, he's so good. Because they think he's now fought off the truth serum. He's able to give a fake occupation. But he's actually just giving the truth. But his self-concept is so little. He's not some big tycoon, powerful president or head of a company. He works at a video store in Iowa. And he's his fun-loving Bill Murray self. You know, he's still going through his lessons, but he's convinced that it's all play action, because he's been told that his brothers paid money for this thing to come to him, and the characters get switched. So he gets in the middle of all these espionage plots and murder and all the things that the world says the worst kind of things. And his perspective is he's absolutely invulnerable, because he thinks it's all just a play. And don't you see that's what the Holy Spirit is working with us on? To do that with our families, our jobs, our countries. He's wanting to say, come on, it's a skit. Remember to laugh. You know, this is laughable. But when you take the characters so seriously and you believe you're a real character and they're real characters and they mean harm to your character, then that's where the fear comes in. And the depression and the anxiety, you know, it's taking all this so seriously.
And it does happen, like, as we go on this journey, the more and more we found we can't interpret everything that is happening, our experience becomes less familiar. You know, you always feel like you're in a zone that you don't really, you have no past reference, you don't really know how to interpret. And the ego really wants to interpret and grab some past reference to say, this is what it means, this is what it's about, put a name, put a label, and try to raise questions so that you can get an answer, you can solve, so that you can get out of this. But this unfamiliar situation, don't try to interpret it as good or bad, or, you know, try to conclude. Just allow yourself to move and stay and move through as time passes by, because that's, believe it or not, it will be actually kind of theme of this awakening journey. You just feel more and more in this unknown zone, and the mind stops trying to interpret anything. And you realize, I don't really know how to interpret anything. And I allow my mind to just to open and to just drop in this vast experience and then see. You know, David used to say this awakening journey is damn. And the ah doesn't happen until the end. It's like this movie. He didn't really know. He was so clueless all throughout the healing until when the whole perspective kicks in, you know. And just don't be disheartened when there is some kind of, you know, disorientation happening, and there's things that you can't interpret or you're not familiar with, or you can't get an immediate answer. Just know that you're going through a journey, moving through darkness, and you're you know, this is a mystical journey. It's an unknown, you know. Seemingly, we're reaching towards something that is completely not in this world. Just keep moving forward, and don't stop and beat yourself up or try to judge anything.
Yeah, I think one of the helpful workbook lessons for me was lesson number 13, a meaningless world engenders fear. He's saying, no, it's not that a hostile world engenders fear or a violent world engenders fear, you know, all these kind of attributes given to the world. It's meaninglessness that arouses great fear in the separated ones. And so, when you think of something like suicide, and you hear somebody having suicidal thoughts, sometimes they will say things like, I've come to the end of my rope, or I've absolutely found no meaning in this world, I'm going to kill myself. They will actually put that meaninglessness before, I'm going to kill myself, I've lost all hope, there's no meaning to be found. And actually, Jesus actually describes this in his text, where he says, all of the rogue ways of the world lead to death. He doesn't say some. Isn't that interesting that he would use a word like all in that sentence? All of the rogue ways of the world lead to death. So imagine that you've, we'll say, incarnated, or you've come to a place where all of the rogue ways of the world lead to death. On some you travel gaily for a while. Okay, isn't that beautiful? Gaily. Sounds kind of Irish. Oh, you know, gaily. Okay, Jesus is, he's quite Irish there. He's just turning that little Irish. They all lead to death, but there are some pretty good roads, and I'm quite gay on a few of those roads. But the thing about it is, you know, we're not really for travel gaily for a while. You know, it's like a trick.
Yeah,
it's like a trick.
I know exactly what you're saying, because underneath that, there's this unhappiness. There's
oh,
this
it's black.
And I'm aware of that.
And he does describe in the back of his text, he says, like, the world is, the self-concept has two tiers. There's the face of innocence, he calls it, on the top. Sometimes it's wet with tears at the injustices of the world and everything, but it's a pretty good person. I'm not too bad of a guy, I'm not too bad of a girl, you know, I'm pretty decent, I'm a decent, but some of these wicked things that happened to me, I didn't even ask for them, and they're just terrible, and I have to cry occasionally, but I wipe it off and travel gaily a little bit more, but, you know, it's very schizophrenic, you know, it's like you're trying your best to be gay, and you feel, but this whole mask is the top tier, and then the bottom tier is so dark that Jesus uses the phrase, the unconscious mind is like draped with sin. Draped. Draped with sin. You know, it's dark. And that's why the top tier was made, so you would never have to look upon what's underneath. Now we get into the course, and oh, here comes, it's coming up. You know, dark nights of the soul, you get to face all the darkest thoughts you've ever had, because now you're calling on the light. You want to wake up from the dream. So I think that's the important thing to remember, is that we're not going for some temporary highs here. We're going for a thorough cleaning, a washing of the mind. I've had some people say to me, I don't know, the course sounds like brainwashing to me. And I say, it is mind-washing. I agree with them. I never try to steer them clear. I say, oh yeah, it's mind-washing, all right. It's more intense than brainwashing. It's really getting in there to the mind, to the crevices, you know, with the light. It's like with a high-powered spray gun and blasting all the crud out of there. So you start to realize what you're in for. But then you look around and you see your mighty companions and you see, wow, I'm drawing forth witnesses of people that seem to be, they're interested in waking up. And they're, even more so than that, they're interested in being transparent and authentic. They're witnessing to me that it's okay to be transparent. I'm not going to be rejected. I'm not going to be thrown away because I have some dark emotions coming up. Isn't that lovely that we're actually making the turn now where it's okay, it's acceptable, we're giving ourselves permission and allowance for that to happen. It's marvelous. It's a marvelous step forward. Because who would want to pretend, you know, with or maintain this pretense? No, none of us. It takes too much energy to hold this mask up. We're finished.
This morning we started with looking at the time. Maybe this is a good place to end because it's where we started this morning with responsibility. Something happened to me this morning, and I thought it was responsibility, but what I'm through the day, I'm realizing it was something to do with unconscious guilt that came up that was just so weird. I just didn't understand it. But before I talk about it, I just have to thank you for going deep. That book changed it all. The second half is just amazing. It's such a once you get it, you get it. It's just fantastic. Anyhow, I went down to for breakfast and overhearing voices. The team didn't arrive to do breakfast, and I'm suddenly, oh my God, it's me. I was supposed to be at breakfast. And I just, this guilt came over me to the point where I had to go look on the board. I knew it wasn't. But I had to go and confirm it on the board upstairs that it wasn't. But I was, this guilt just completely overpowered me, and I'm kind of thinking, was that all about? What was it for? You know, and it just feels like this last 6 months I've followed this real nice steady path, and it's logical and it made sense. And now again, I hear the voice. I hear it, and it's, and of course, part of me realizes I've always heard it, but it just, I wasn't listening. And then suddenly I'm faced with a thing like that, and I just have absolutely no idea where it came from or what it's about. How do I work with something like that?
I guess we're trained to just be ready for anything, absolutely anything. Like you might, if you were doing some kind of a deep discipline, any kind of discipline, or including a spiritual discipline, Jesus does have a part in the Course where he says, you know, the miracles will help prepare your mind for what seems to be the crisis or the emergency, which will come Out of the blue, that's the name of your show. Out of the blue comes Francis. Out of the blue comes guilt for you this morning. Like, whoa, what, hey, I'm having a pretty good awakening journey here, and where did you come from? And the Loch Ness Monster comes up. But the thing about it is, you know, myself and the messengers, that's you're describing our lives. We've had to be ready because things just come at us. There wasn't long ago you were down in Mexico and it was something with abscessed teeth and your whole face just blew up like a balloon. But then again, all you can do is mind watch. You didn't talk to me when it was happening, but afterwards you said, I thought I was going to die. I just was like really thinking, die, you know, because it just was. But then again, it just came out of the blue. It came unexpected or whatever. And all you can do is, again, watch your mind.
Yeah, because that really explains that we don't really need to dig. Because things will come up, like whatever that's unconscious, once we give the invitation to the spirit, it will come up when the time is right, when you're ready. So there is no real cause and effect of what informed causes what happens. Just when it comes up, there is a invitation, because there is a deep invitation. And then as they come up, you know, we don't try to, definitely not trying to solve them so that we don't experience them. Just know, okay, there's something very deep that's arising. Yeah, and then all that we can do is to not suppress and to the best ability to really allow it to unfold and to reveal itself. Maybe expressing will be helpful, maybe talking will be helpful, maybe just noticing it, but just not trying to avoid it or how do I fix it? How do I, so that I don't experience it? It happens for a reason, you know, it happens for a reason at this time. And then just as long as we're willing to just allow it, then just know that healing is under the control of the Holy Spirit. It's not something that we need to bring up. It's not something that we need to fix. It's the Holy Spirit. And our cooperation with the Holy Spirit is just not to hide it and to just, yeah, this is on my mind. I notice it. What is the most helpful? The form will be very guided. Maybe you feel guided to express. Maybe you feel guided to get into some kind of project or function. That part is completely will be shown to you, you know.
That's again why we need purpose and function so much, because when something comes up and we judge it as horrific, you notice how the mind wants to then put a lot of attention to it. Figure it out, and all these. It's just.
Suddenly, I'm going into victim mode. You know, I wasn't even on duty, and I'm feeling guilty because of.
Yeah. There's no logical reason for it. It's just. It's somewhere deep in your mind. It was like you allowed it. You allowed it up, and then more than that, we have to stay with that allowance and allow it to be given over, allow it to pass. Oftentimes, it helps to have a focus, a function, or a purpose that you are doing, giving you that. Fulfillment, that energy, that momentum, that motivation, when we're serving spirit in some helpful way, it gives us more energy. It gives us more energy. And we need all that in order to let this darkness pass through us. We can't just sit back and go, waiting for it to come. You know, that's not going to work either. Okay, I'm ready. It's going to be today. You drop the atomic bomb on me today of my emotions. You know, that's not, you can't live in that. But you can live in a joyful way of serving and doing what you're inspired to do and growing in that joy. Like Sandy's been saying, there's this intense joy that grows stronger and stronger, and it's almost, I can't handle it. And that's a good problem to have, bubbling joy, you know. The ego, it doesn't like that at all. It's like it's threatened by that. I've even had our friend Lisa, she worked with course groups and temples and different things, and at one point she was going to this one Course in Miracles group in Pennsylvania, this temple, and she would come and she would have all this joy. She would just let it burst through her and burst through her. And then she came home one day, the people in her course group had said something to her, and she called me up and she said, my course group told me to tone down my joy. So almost like a puppy dog with a tail between it. They told me to tone down my joy. Was that the Holy Spirit? I say, no, it was not. You see how sneaky it is. Even when your course group tells you to tone down the joy, then you see how it can come in any kind of witness. We just can't buy the bait, you know. We just cannot buy the bait.
I remember my course group, when I started seeing the course as a toolbox and not as a marvelous piece of poetry or whatever they wanted to see it as, then it changed. Oh, I tell you, this barrow just came at me like, you can't believe it. How dare I say this?
Ha ha.